Hello everybody, Thy Lord Roots here, and welcome back to another episode of Kerbal Aerospace Program. So I think our space plane design for last time, or from last time, was actually pretty good. We managed to get into space. And I thought maybe we would set ourselves up a bit more of a challenge. We would try to get to Minmus. Now here we just happen to have something I want to show you real quick. I want to show you this air hogging technique that I used in order to fit more parts, more air intakes onto the plane. So what you want to do is you want to get to wherever you want to attach your air intakes, right, where you'd normally put them, and you want to get yourself a cubic octagonal stripe. And what we'll do here is we'll stick it right here in the center as close as we can. It's a little bit off, but that's okay. Now what we can do there is we can go grab these intakes, and we can put it on the front, of course, but now we can put it on the back as well. And so we'll do that. We'll go in and we will turn this thing around, and now we have two intakes we can put on here. In fact, we can put one more on there. That gives us a plane with three air intakes. And so the thing here is that if we do that, and you can see I've gone through several iterations working from the base model, we can create ourselves a rather nice plane. This is my first design I had. You can see I'm using the Mark II cockpit, and I'm using that design and some of the Rapier engines. It turns out that four air intakes doesn't really work all that well with the Rapier engines. You really want to have at least two for each engine if you do that, otherwise you'll run out of air quickly. Even though it's a cool looking plane and it's pretty squat, I mean it's not really the kind of plane I was going for. And you'll notice here I've actually got a rather complex fuel flow going on here. Basically, these tanks feed into this middle tank, which then feeds into these side tanks here. And these are just fuselage sections here. But the virtue of this, of course, is that you now end up in a situation to where you have your fuel being balanced no matter what happens, and that's pretty nice. That keeps the center of mass from moving too much. So if I had replaced those engines there with maybe the small Rockamax engines were these, I could get up, but it wouldn't be easy. And as you can see, this is actually fairly it's not too terribly heavy, but I thought maybe I could do better. And so here comes iteration two, where I went back to the drawing board with that design, and you can see here I went through, added more air intakes, went back to the deal going on here. It won't let me move around for some reason, so we can't really see that. I'll just grab. Oh, grand, the user interface is frozen. Well, I guess I'm going to splice those two videos together on this. Okay, we're back. Now I can move around a little bit. You can see now I've got, these eight intakes, and we're at about 16k here, but this design's a little bit more compact, which is really nice, and we have sufficient air takes for each engine. However, when I was designing this, I was looking at the cost instead of the mass, and this thing might actually be able to get up into the atmosphere just fine. Or it might even be able to leave just fine. Just looking at the mass, I'm like, wow, this is not very much in the way of, this is too much mass, because I was looking at this cost here. And so I decided to go through with a third iteration, and then, you know, I realized midway that we have, that we were using the cost. Even though we did manage to bring that down, and we also managed to bring down the actual, mass of it as well. I wonder if this is, related to Kerbal Engineer losing focus or something. Well, I'm gonna restart KSP again. I'll be back. Hopefully third time's a charm here. So at any rate, we did go through a bit of a substantial redesign. I do want to note here that the way that I designed this fuel system was to use these, you go here to structural, you have these structural panels. I'm using those as firewalls in order to keep the fuel from crossing over. And then, of course, we switched back to this docking port right here, which hopefully, I don't really want to move that guy forward too much, but we might. I think we might, have trouble docking if I don't, because I haven't tried docking in this thing yet. We'll just move this landing gear forward a little bit. And you'll notice I've got it all strutted up. Most of the fuel lines here are underwater. Or not underwater, but underneath the plane. It'd be interesting if they were underwater. I might try to do a seaplane at some point, but you know, not today. We'll leave that for another time. This thing actually flies pretty well. We have two jet engines, which means we run the risk of flaming out, but we can handle that pretty well. So if you go up here, we have this action group here. LV-909, a single one, because once we get into space, you know, we'll have all the time in the world to do our thrust. But our thrust there is like some, I know it's below unity. We couldn't get out of the atmosphere with the level of thrust we have. Action group 3 closes the top half of our ram intakes. And 4 shuts down the engines. And, you know, shuts off the other half. And so we'll be using 1 initially, because the thing we have going on here is that, you know, we really don't want to turn off our intakes while we're in flight, or while we're trying to get off the ground. So I'll use 1, but then I'll stop using it afterwards. So we'll go to cockpit view, and hopefully I'll remember to raise the landing gear this time. And once we do that, other things that we've, you know, added on to refit this to space, of course, is, or for space, is power management, so we don't run out of power. And, RCS as well, so that we can maneuver in orbit. So this thing is actually fairly stable. We'll just turn on SAS, turn on our jet engines. And I'm going to try a little bit different of a profile here. We'll just go to our regular flight levels. And once we get up to about 100 or so, in fact, we'll start pitching back now, but we should start lifting off around 100 meters per second or so. We want to be careful here, because we don't want to overdo it here. You can see I've already used a lot of intake air, but we'll get that back pretty soon. And I'm going to pitch all the way up to 60. Normally, you probably wouldn't want to do this, but I've been watching other people's flight profiles on this. This does get you out of the atmosphere way faster, for sure. That's one nice thing about it. I'm gonna move flight engineer over here, I think. I wish there was a way to make it a little bit more compact. But that way we can sort of tell where we are, and we're getting our intake air back fairly quickly. Now, the entire purpose behind this air hogging is so that we can run on max thrust a whole lot faster. Now it's time for us to start pitching down a little bit once we have, you know, the amount of vertical speed we have, because we are losing intake air very slightly. And we want to gain some forward velocity. In fact, we're gonna, since we're at the level we're at, we're going to start pitching down a little bit. We're going to get to maybe 20 degrees or so. Because we're now using a lot of air. I'm probably going to speed through this, since we've already seen getting into space from here.
1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Off we go into the wild blue yonder, climbing high into the sun. Here they come, zooming to meet our thunder. Adam Boy's given the gun. Down we dive, spotting a flame from under. Off with one hell of a roar. We live in fame, or we go down in flames. Ain't nothing can stop the U.S. Air Force. Minds have been patched a crate of thunder, sent it high into the blue. And some men blasted the world asunder. How they lived, God only knew. Souls of men, dreaming of skies to conquer, gave us wings ever to soar. With scouts before and bombers galore, nothing can stop the U.S. Air Force.
So now it's time for main engine cutout, and we're going to just bring our engines up to full throttle here. We do have a rather fair amount of intake air here, but I'm not going to risk it too much. Because of the profile that I've taken, we haven't really been able to get up too far into the atmosphere. However, at this point we just want to gain altitude. Our orbital velocity is going to be our primary concern here. So we're at least out of the thick part of the atmosphere, and we want to bring up our, we want to bring up our time to apoapsis. And you know what, I think I forgot to put my gear down, or gear up rather. That might have helped. I'm always forgetting about my gear. It does, unfortunately, make this more difficult. We are losing a substantial amount of velocity here. But the problem here, of course, is that, you know what, I'll kick on my engines just a little bit. gain some velocity back. And get our time to apoapsis down. It looks like we have a bit of a balance issue here. Or maybe it's just, RCS going nuts, but we're going to get our time to apoapsis up high enough. Once we do that, it shouldn't be anything for us to circularize this orbit. And once we do that, we want to do our standard orbital insertion maneuver, which will be happening presently. Unfortunately, this means we don't have much in the way of fuel, because if you look here, we're going to... We'll have plenty of delta V, of course, but... That's going to be, something that we're going to have to worry about. Our inclination is okay, I think. But because I noticed this during the test run, the, oh, I see why we're pitching over, we're banking a little bit. You know, we're going to go ahead and get this thing, you know, up into a respectable orbit. And then we have a fuel station that we can rendezvous with that I've gone ahead and put up, because what I'd like to do is I'd like to go to Minmus. Are we? Oh, we're out of oxidizer. I thought I had accounted for that. Well, that's okay. We have RCS. Not much of it, unfortunately. I managed to get this thing into orbit earlier, but maybe, the issue there is that we, we ran out of fuel too early. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to revert to the space plane hangar and make a couple of tweaks here. We'll just, do two things. We'll bring this up to 176 on both of these, because it's fairly clear to me that we're going to run out of fuel otherwise. I'm also going to put these, if I can find them, I'll put two RCS engines on here. We want to make sure they're balanced, of course. And we'll see if we can get these guys pointing the right direction. That way we could use RCS in order to get us up into orbit if we absolutely run out of fuel. I'm gonna add an action group for that. We're going to make that action group 5. And then what we'll do here, we'll leave that for right now. This time I'm going to bring down the gear as soon as I take off. So I'm just going to time accelerate this. And we'll try again. Maybe Jeb isn't nearly as good of a pilot as Bob, I don't know. But we'll get that up and going. It turns out that this thing does have a little bit less in the way of fuel than I'd originally hoped for. But now that we've seen it through the cockpit view, we'll do this up here for now. Okay, so here we are taking off. I figured I'd speed up this process by about 32 times in order to make the process go a little bit smoother. Because I figured y'all probably did not want to go through the entire, you know, ascent profile. And so here we are very quickly leveling off and getting up to speed. And I decided to take a little bit less of an aggressive approach this time. I still did the 60 degree, you know, pitch on my ascent at the beginning. But then I decided I was going to do whatever I could in order to make sure that we conserved a little bit more fuel, in fact. So we will find out that we did overdo a very little bit our oxidizer because of this. You see Jeb there, because of the speed, he's wigging out like he's on some kind of, I don't know, maybe methamphetamine. You just can't keep old Jeb still, can you? But at any rate, we're currently at the process of getting as much juice as we can out of this, because it did occur to me that I probably gave up on my jet a little bit too early. And you'll see as we get down, it will take a little bit of a while because this is by far one of the more involved parts, but you'll begin to see these parts where, you know, when my air runs out here, I notice I'm getting more in the way of air. And so I'm toggling my engines on and off while I've got my rocket burning. My rocket engine, rather, that LV-909. And that gets me up pretty quickly. As you can see, I'm just running the engine on low throttle at this point until we get out of the atmosphere in order to ensure that we've got a fairly stable apoapsis. It's not going to be in the atmosphere. Here I'm performing SARC, and that doesn't take too long because most of our speed requirements were already met. And at this point, I'm trying to meet up with the space probe, and I have to take a little bit different of an approach here because of the fact that we don't have much in the way of delta V. Add maybe 500, or maybe 550 meters per second of delta V coming out of the atmosphere. And I was basically wanting to get as slow of an approach as I could so that I don't have to make a huge burn when I caught up. And so we're getting closer and closer. I'm adjusting my apses here in order to make that approach as slow as possible. And this is by far one of the longer parts of this video. But you'll see that we're... Oh yeah, I guess I did do an inclination change there as well, but
We're getting closer and closer, and you'll see at this point I decide to do a little bit of trimming in order to get these things closer in. And by the end of it, I get like 0.05 or 0.5 separation distance on these. And I think I'm coming in at around 70 meters a second, I want to say. It's hard for me to read because I have the screen shrunk, but at this point, we're getting ready to.
Okay, rendezvous should happen fairly shortly. I've just got to get in close. And how close? Well, close enough. We're 1 minute 43 seconds in. And I want to make sure we don't fly by this thing. So let's go ahead and get docking up and going. We'll begin pushing back our approach a bit, and we'll come in at 5 meters per second. So this thing is at least agile enough to be able to do some very basic rendezvous. Maybe we could have gone to Minmus by this point, I don't know, but with that having been said, I don't want to, I don't want to be going too fast when I come in here. Because if we are, that will be a problem. Let's go ahead. We'll select this docking port right here, and we will get ourselves down to about 40 or so. And we'll begin our docking. We are going to open up this thingy right here, and we will dock immediately. Hopefully the RCS is balanced enough on this. So let's go ahead, we'll pull this thing over just a bit. I may not even worry too much about rotation in this case. But once we do that, we'll go through and start refueling. And we're going to run into all sorts of weird balance issues when we try to move this, because this is not in the best possible orientation it could be. I'm thinking I want to make this lower, maybe like, 80k I think would be good. Maybe 100 would be even better. 140 is going to be difficult with the amount of fuel we have. However, the RCS does seem to be fairly well balanced here. I'm a little bit surprised about that, truth be told. Because RCS on space planes is a little bit difficult to get balanced correctly. You usually don't end up in a situation to where you have the center of mass in a convenient place to put the really whatever it is you're, you know, wherever you're trying to put your RCS ports. And so that can be a problem. But once we do this, once we finish docking and moving this into a better orbit here, I want us to go ahead and, I'll probably leave the video there, and I will, when we get done, I will get us set up properly for going to Minmus. The reason I'm going to Minmus and not the moon is actually rather simple. Minmus is easier to get off of. In fact, I'm not even sure if the landing conditions are right on the moon, but I know I could probably land this thing on the moon if I tried. That's something to think about. Because landing on the moon is, it's just, the terrain's just not right, for one. Dock like this, I think. Maybe I should have been properly oriented to begin with, but A little bit too late for that now. At any rate, this thing has more or less surpassed my expectations on this. I didn't know if we were going to have enough fuel to dock with our space station, and I'm glad to see that we did. Because that makes it a lot easier. That means once we get this thing down into orbit, or out down to a better orbit rather, because it is in orbit already, once we get it into a better orbit, we're going to find this much easier to dock with. Now, when I locked, when I docked this, or when I launched it rather, initially, I wasn't even going to bother with making it particularly sound, or in a particularly sound orbit rather. So I figured, what's a better test than to see if we can take this plane and if it has enough power to reorient. But I think that's a fairly good test, to be honest. I think if this thing does work as intended, we should have no problem putting this thing into a better orbit, the space station here. We can move it around laterally, that's not really an issue. What will be the issue is really whether or not whether or not we can get this thing in a this target screwed up. Whether or not we can get this thing in a better orbit. So we just missed Apoapsis, however. I do want to go ahead and see if we can, let's control from here. I do want to lower its orbit substantially, and it is a bit unwieldy. However, that's going to, we're rotating a bit. We're changing its inclination. No wonder we're moving around. Let's just bring up our orbital information. Let's see, what we want to do here is we want to, we might as well, let's bring down our periapsis to 100. Okay, maybe that isn't such a good idea. I mean, our inclination is coming down quite a bit, fortunately. But we're going to have to be very slow with this. Otherwise, we will probably lose control. Because the center of mass isn't in a really good place. But we got plenty of fuel to burn on here. So what might be interesting is if we had a refueling craft that we would make. Let's bring this guy down just a little bit. First of all, we want to bring Apsis down to, what did I say, about 100? Maybe even 90 would be better. That way we could get into, 80. 80's nice. That way we can get this guy into a relatively good position here. That's going to be something like a 21 second burn. I'm going to very slowly do this because I will probably go off course if I don't. Which means I'm probably going to burn about a minute or so in. SAS seems to be having trouble with keeping up with this, even though I've got plenty of reaction wheels on there. Let's just keep this thing nice and stable. You know what, while we're at it, we'll bring down the periapsis as well. We're at the periapsis. Well, yeah, the periapsis is actually coming down slightly. But that's not what I want to do. I want to bring this guy down. Fairly close, I think. Fairly close to that 80. And then we'll do any orbital, like any plane correction. Fairly soon. We won't worry about plane correction the next go. There we go. That's good. It's good enough for me, anyhow. And now we're very highly eccentric. And not because we're weird, just because we're, you know, about 40 meters off. So what I'm gonna do now is, now that periapsis is down, I'm going to bring this guy down to about 80 or so. That won't take long, I don't think. Hopefully it won't take much delta V either. I just gotta get this thing centered correctly. That is a reasonable apoapsis, I think. We'll just, we'll get this guy up and going. And I think we will be good from there. We've still got plenty of fuel left here, though, which is nice. I like having plenty of fuel. Maybe when we do this, I'm hoping our periapsis will raise just a little bit. If we can't keep this thing straight. That's the deal about moving these big craft that are much bigger than your ship. That is not optimal, I don't think. We'll just raise, we'll raise periapsis, up here, I think. And why don't we do ourselves a favor and get this aligned to the equator. I don't really know that it's necessary, but we have a descending node here, which is nice. And we can raise periaps at the same time here. Versus 81. And that is going to be hardly anything. I'm not even sure at the moment that the shuttle could... Whoa, I missed my burn point for sure. Okay. That's good. That's good enough for me, anyhow. We'll just want to put this in a decent orientation. Maybe pointing north. And our eccentricity is such that this thing should no longer drift. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to start filling these tanks up so we can go to Minmus, because Minmus is a reasonable goal, I think. I think it's certainly attainable with help here. Most SSTOs, I don't think, would be able to hit Minmus very easily, but in our case, we can hit it just fine. We need some 900 meters of delta V to get to Minmus in the first place. And we need several more in order to get out there. So I don't know if we're going to be able to, at this point, get there. It looks like it may happen. But I may need to build a purpose-built SSTO in order to entertain that idea. Yeah, it looks like that's not happening. So what we'll do is we'll try to land this thing, and we will we'll build a better SSTO. That seems like the best option here, because I don't think we're going to be able to get to Minmus with this thing, and I really do want to, but that's not going to help us at all. So 32.5 units of fuel, I think, is what we want. In order to balance this out, we're going to be a bit top heavy, I think, but oh, we do have liquid fuel in here though. Let's do this. Let's give ourselves about maybe 60 units of fuel. There will be balance issues here, but you know, to be honest, that may not be so bad. We don't need any more oxidizer. For sure. Thank you. I think that's well enough balanced on this front. We just need to, balance this out to about 55 or so. Oh, we're a little bit top heavy here, but we'll consider this a good victory. And we'll just go ahead and we'll land. Get out of the way of this space station. And begin our landing procedure. Doesn't really matter where we land, but we do want to land pretty close, I think, to land. Hence why it is called landing. We'll get the sky down to 30, I think. Nice shallow orbit. Or not shallow re-entry, rather. Because I guess you can't really call it. Well, it is an orbit, but you can't really call it an orbit proper. And I'll see what I can do to maybe make this thing a little bit more agile. Maybe we need a better design. But we'll go ahead, we'll time accelerate. And we will get on down to this atmosphere. In fact, we need to level out just a little bit. We won't hit KSC this time, I fear, but this is a good time to test the landing abilities of this craft. So let's bring up our orbital information. We no longer need these engines, so we'll make sure that our intakes are open for this. Because we may need to do some traveling. Traveling is probably going to be good here. Although I think, honestly, we can probably land on this continent here in front of us. We'll just have to be very, very careful when we do it. Get ourselves this cockpit view, except the display is bogged because we have the target selected. So we may not be able to land that way. We should be hitting the atmosphere any second now. And if this were deadly re-entry, it would probably kill us. But since it's not, I'll deal with that. We came in a little bit too steeply, I think. So let's take advantage of the fact that we're going fairly fast and let's, let's bring this up a little bit. Let's try to get to a spot that is relatively easy to get to. And that will happen soon. I can already see the coast here. But let's turn a bit. I think I'll go the other way, though. Or maybe I didn't put enough fuel on this thing, though. But I think we did get up high enough to where we can do something here. We've slowed ourselves down quite a deal. Now, I do have to be careful because let's just close this real quick. It might be good not to break this thing. The real question is going to be when we land this thing. And at this point, it is going to be a question of when rather than if. Will it snap in half? Because this thing does flex a little bit. At any rate, I want this to be somewhat of a guided re-entry. And I do want to make sure that when we land, that we're able to brake efficiently as well. So we'll use our jets running very, very slowly. In order to make sure that we at least get over land. Which I think will happen, but you never know. This may be Jeb's last days as a pilot, but then again, you can't really say that about Jeb. Jeb always has a way of coming back. the name of the game here is going to be able to create as much drag as possible. Because in this case, I'm fairly certain we'll hit land. That's not going to be the problem. The question is, can we hit land without tearing ourselves apart? Also, can we hit land without running into this lake that we might run into? Let's just move a little bit out of the way there. Because that will help us in the long run. And then once we do that, we want to get our vertical speed down quite a bit. We want it to come down to maybe 10 at most, that we have a nice touchdown. But that will have to, that'll have to wait a little bit, because before we touch down, we actually have to come pretty close to land. Let's get an idea by looking at our radar altimeter, how far down we are. I mean, certainly we do want to bring this thing down as quickly as possible, but without breaking anything. And we're going to pitch down very slightly here. This radar altimeter will probably end up going down here in a bit. Although I'm not terribly sure if the terrain altitude here. In fact, I'm not sure if we're over land yet. That could be part of it, because we're probably still technically above the sea. Let's slow down our descent just a little bit, maybe to 10 meters a second. Because this will be dropping presently. In fact, it already has, according to this. Once we get overland, which we almost are, then we'll want to, you know, we'll want to turn here a little bit. We may be landing uphill. In fact, that probably will be the case. But let's get this thing down to a respectable level at least. Maybe something to the order of several thousand. Or not several thousand, that would be too high. We want to get down to about 1,000. And we'll get this thing landed. Now the question is, will landing uphill, as we're about to do, hurt us in the long run with this design? I think the answer to that is probably. I'm not sure that the design can really handle the stress all that well. There's really nothing we can do about it at this point. I mean, we've really got too much going on here. And in fact, if I can, I don't know if there's going to be any real way to, well, that works actually. That may be better for us to land like this at this, maybe in a northerly direction. We still are a little bit too high for my liking, but we'll just, you know, we'll have to deal with that when the time comes. So it's probably time pretty soon to start thinking about pitching up so we can do a flared landing. I'm gonna lower my engine output a little bit. And we are going to run into a hill, it looks like. I'll be prepared. I'm bringing my gear down right now, which should create a fair amount of drag. We're going to cut off our engine and just glide in. Hopefully not too quickly. It looks like there's not going to be much in the way for me to do here in order to correct this. I think I'll put the fine control button right next to the to shift. Alright, now we need to control our descent a little bit more. Because we are very, very close to landing, it looks like. And I will be landing up a hill again. I can only hope that this thing will keep together. I won't tell strike this time, but I will probably end up in the situation to where I'm not going to be able to do much in order to I'm not going to be able to do much in order to stop myself if I hit the wrong kind of land. But too much of a slope the wrong way. But we'll give this a try. Maybe Jeb will survive. And miraculously, somehow I have. We'll just kick on the brakes here, the parking brakes. Well, this has been Thy Lord Root, and I will see you later.